So we're reconvening this afternoon meeting of the Salt Spring Trust Committee. Thanks to members of the public for being here. I'm Sheila Malcolmson. I'm the chair of the committee. On my left, your local trustees, Peter Grove and George Grams, our minute taker, Catherine Luton, and our CRD director, Wayne McIntyre. Very glad that you're here. And our planning manager, Leah Hartley. I'm acknowledged that we're meeting on traditional territory of Coast Salish people and acknowledge their longtime stewardship. We are the part of local government that's charged with the zoning of land. This is our once every 3 week business meeting for us to do our business. We can't decide things or debate things behind closed doors, so this is our time to do our business in view of the public. It is mostly meant as a decision-making meeting where we give direction to staff. But that said, we do have 45 minutes set aside for public input, and we're really glad you're here to give that. When we are going to have a public hearing or actually have a draft bylaw that we want to focus a meeting just on public input, we'll hold it at a more public-friendly time of the day, evenings or weekends. So thanks again for being here this afternoon to witness our work. We have got a videographer that is being paid for by the local trust committee expense account. The intention is that the camera is focused on the trustees and the planner. Members of the public, if you'd like to be on camera when you give your presentation, this is your spot to be, and we'll swing the mic around so that you can be well heard. And but if you'd rather not be recorded, then just say so, and you don't need to be on the screen. We are going to move to section 7 of the agenda, which are the trustee reports, and I'll invite the local trustees to report out to your community.
Okay, I'll report two interesting events I participated in. On May the 1st, I attended the Ferry Commission meeting with the BC Ferry reps. And you know, we really are very lucky to have such a dedicated group working on that Ferry Commission, chaired by Harold Swirenga. And they are looking after our interests as best they can, and there's a really good report from Harold in this week's edition of the Driftwood, which I do suggest you look at. On May the 8th, I attended a meeting of the Kushan Lake Stewardship Committee. And again, this is a group that's been working with that lake for many, many years. John Brost is its chair. They've been monitoring the water quality and the land activity around there since some... Well, I'm not sure how far back it goes. But, you know, in 1999, Vihar closed that lake, not only for drinking purposes and swimming purposes, but even for boating activities. It was green, blue scum. You know, so a lot has happened since then, and Kushan is looking a lot healthier. So these things can be improved and with careful stewardship and work. Just as an aside, but you know, I finally learnt that the problem is phosphorus, and the phosphorus that finds its way into our lakes. And it gets there basically through two significant ways. One is land runoff, and when there's phosphorus in the land, naturally so, and our plants require it. But when we turn over a sod of earth, we release that phosphorus and make it accessible to the lake through water runoff. So when we look at Kushan Lake, which has a very large watershed, any uncontrolled development, if you like, or any uncontrolled movement of soil, digging it up, in other words, can have a significant effect on the phosphorus level in the lakes. So those issues, which are very much close to the heart of the trust, being land issues, need to be monitored and looked at. And the other issue, of course, is septics, and you'll be hearing more about that anon. And there are things we can do, and we're all going to be working hard towards improving it. Thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Grove. Trustee Grams.
Since our last meeting on the 27th of March, I've had the usual regular and various meetings with constituents and island residents about a variety of topics. We had a meeting with the advisory group facilitator, Ian Clement, Sebastian Moffat, and planning staff to discuss how we could further refine and advisory group's exploration and how we might possibly construct a workshop too that might provide benefit in terms of community input. We convened our first committee meeting with respect to the joint CRD trustee sewage event, and that was successful, I believe. It gave us some direction. Everyone attended apart from one individual, Ron Bain, who is in the committee, who couldn't attend. I was voted in as chair and Peter Lake as vice chair, but in reflection, I think I suggested that I not be chair. The reason being that I participate a lot during the meeting and technical issues, and trying to chair a meeting and also be fully active in the discussion are almost contradictory. So I'm relieved to say that Keith Ruhr has stepped in to accept the position of chair, and we'll have that voted in at the next committee meeting. But we're underway with the formulation and the arrangement, the organisation of the sewage event. Now, running parallel with that, we know we have to deal with potable water on island, and Peter touched on that. And we had a meeting again with CRD Director Wayne McIntyre, where we explored one of the propositions that was proposed by planning manager Leah Hartley, which we believe offers the best approach. And that's forming a working group that comprises all the regulatory bodies who have an interest in potable water. And that's CRD, it's VIHA, it's the Islands Trust, and it's North Salt Spring Water District. And so we would like, I would like to have that proposal endorsed by the LTC. Perhaps we have a draft motion that was prepared by Planner Stark, and I'm hoping that we can find the facility to either raise that at the meeting today, or if not, bring it forward at the next one. I'd also like the LTC to endorse the sewage event, because that allows us to tap into both some access to funding, and it will also provide staff support for that event. So running the sewage event and having the working group on potable water, I think, tackles both ends of our water issue, delivery and what we do with it after disposal. And I think completing that life cycle is an important and essential component of trying to find resolution in that issue. I attended a Trust Programmes Committee meeting in Ladysmith, where we discussed a number of issues, the Islands Trust strategic plan. We examined the policy statement options. I received a briefing on Islands Trust advocacy policy. Yesterday, I spent the day in Victoria attending a local planning committee meeting, and we had a briefing from planners on using wind power in the trust area. We discussed the fee structure for land use applications, which is still being formulated. We discussed the Islands Trust strategic plan again, obtained a briefing on progress with shoreline mapping, and benefited from a very interesting presentation from the Sea Change Foundation and the work they're undertaking on issues of marine conservation and foreshore protection. Thank you.
Thanks. For section 8 of the agenda, I'll give a brief chair's report. I guess one of the trust-wide things that's been on our horizon since the Trust Committee last met 3 weeks ago is the province's announcement of the changes to the Ferry Act. Quite a few of the advocacy areas that the advisory committees have been making in the respective communities, as well as Trust Council's past advocacy positions, quite a lot of them were reflected in the proposal that's coming forward. So on a optimistic note, there are certainly lots to acknowledge there. Removal of the requirement for user pay, which isn't a requirement for any other form of public transit or road, but had been part of the Coastal Ferry Act that was brought in 2002. So glad to see that proposed to be removed, as well as the requirement, the old requirement that there be no cross-subsidization between routes. Again, that's not a principle that's used in any other public transit system anywhere else. You don't, you know, charge one rate for the route that's used heavily and a higher one for the one that doesn't have a lot of ridership on it. So we're glad to see that gone. Glad to see some increased contribution from the province. The ferry commissioner had estimated that the province has saved $100 million since the Coastal Ferry Act had been brought in by not increasing the provincial contribution with inflation. And the commissioner recommended that a $50 million a year contribution from the province would be necessary to prevent further rate hikes. So that is not something that the province offered, and in fact, quite a bit of the contribution is going to go just to pay expenses already paid. So certainly not the total win that we were looking for, but we recognize there's lots of competing demands on provincial resources, and this certainly goes the furthest way to what ferry-dependent communities have been asking for the last 8 or so years. So appreciate all the community advocacy that supported that, and we'll have to work together at a trust council level around next steps. Certainly some of the discussions around service reductions are going to be anxiety creating in our communities, and we're going to have to spend some time thinking about how proactively to have those tough conversations that the province has signaled that they are going to be having with us, whether we like it or not. On a happier note, stewardship award nominations that Trust Council considers, the deadline closed the day after our last meeting, and very pleased to see Salt Spring, I think, over time has had something like 24 nominations over the 10 or 11 year history of the project. Three Salt Spring Islanders were nominated this time. Anne Macy, who is often in our trust committee meetings, either as an applicant or an advocate, certainly recognized the nomination recognized her contribution towards the farm plan on Salt Spring, which is a real model for the rest of the trust area, and her specific work around then implementing both the farm plan and OCP policies around food security, agriculture protection, mobile abattoir, just a great list of accomplishments there. And then very pleased to see John Sprague nominated for protection of freshwater, protection of wetlands and drinking water sources, really good to see. And Bob Watson also, lots of potable water modeling and potable water supply, which are just some of the things that we were talking about this morning at the Trust Committee. So congratulations to those three Salt Spring Islanders very much. We will be making the tough decision around who receives the awards at the June Trust Council meeting. That's when all 26 trustees from all 470 or so islands meet together. That's June 13. We're going to be making that decision. But we certainly try to do our very best to amplify and distribute the benefits of the work of everybody that's nominated, even though there's just a handful of the, I think we had a record number of nominations, something like 21 this year. Previous Salt Spring Award winners under this program include, just in recent years, Dorothy Cutting, the Salt Spring Island Conservancy, for their Stewards in Training program with school kids, Kelsey Metch, Jacqueline Booth, late Jacqueline Booth, Maureen Moore, the Gypsy Moth program that was really innovative on Salt Spring, I think 5 or 6 years ago, and Tom Gossett, again, for wetland work. So, and there's a longer list as well, but just want to say thanks to all the community volunteers and businesses that help carry out the mandate of preservation and protection. We elected people cannot do it on our own, so their work is appreciated. And then maybe just a final note on the stewardship awards, just on a sad note, yesterday was the funeral service for Tekla Deverell, who's a North Pender resident, a winner of a stewardship award in 2010 for an amazing program that she developed on youth mentorship in relation to organic gardening, farming, and that's still having big impacts in her community and had been taken out to other communities up Sunshine Coast and other places. So very sad to see the loss of her to the activist and conservation world, as well as to the Pender community. And I know our colleague Ken Hancock was a very close friend, and she was the one that talked him into running for Islands Trust in the first place. So we're thinking of him today. Thank you. I'll turn to our regional director, Wayne McIntyre, under item 9 on the agenda, to thank you for being here and welcoming your report.
Oh, thank you again for the invitation. It's always a pleasure. And through the chair, I've got a few things to say. First of all, I'd like to say that it's been great to work with Peter and George in looking at some of these water and sewer issues collectively. I think that's going to be the only way things are going to happen. I want to give a few quick highlights on some of the things that have been happening that are I think are currently relevant to the community. Last week was the CRD board meeting, and it was the inaugural meeting of the CRD Transportation Special Committee, which I've been appointed to, and the focus will be on regional-wide transportation issues. It's one of the strategic priorities for the CRD, and it'll focus on governance, looking at the MOTI's role, BC Transit, et cetera, as well as funding. So there's a particular model here, and what the model indicates is what we'll be focusing on will be governance options, doing a feasibility study, and a funding strategy. And there'll be local funding options task force, looking at gas tax regional significant projects allocations. And I think the benefit from my perspective of being on this particular group is understanding what everybody else is doing and understanding what potential funding pots might be available to Salt Spring. So I think that'll work out well. Bello Village, we know that's going to be happening on Salt Spring Island on June 21st through the 23rd. The CRD has been tremendously cooperative in helping out on that in the conference. Of course, it's cycling and rural mobility conference. And the kind of support the CRD has provided has been financial, actually staff, and they're going to have some staff at the event to help out with the various logistics. And we'll be providing some material branding and support, as well as it's been put on the front page of the most recent CRD publication, their annual the newsletter they publish. So the Bello Village has got front page coverage. So I think the CRD has been really pitching in on hoping to help this event become very successful. As part of that process, there was a resolution that I presented at the last CRD board meeting, and it was passed. And of course, the CRD has 13 municipalities in the 3 electoral districts. And the motion was supporting more to be done with rural cycling infrastructure across the province. And a letter is being prepared and will be going out very shortly from the CRD chair to Minister Lekstrom and also the Union of BC Municipalities, supporting more activity to be taken across the province on rural cycling initiatives. And also bringing it forward to the UBCM convention that will be held in September. Another thing that happened at the board meeting that's relevant to Salt Spring Island was there's a strategic priorities gas tax fund, which only comes up with a very short cycle in order to get your ore in the water. And you have about a 6-week window to get your application in. So at the last board meeting, the CRD application will include a Salt Spring Island component for water and sewer. And as an addendum to that submission, if approved, the commissions on Salt Spring will have the opportunity to input on the priorities. I think that's always been an issue on Salt Spring, to make sure that they feel that they're being listened to. So that's part of the resolution. If we get the funding, which hopefully will be announced relatively soon, then that will be the next step, is to sit down with the commissions and how they want the money allocated. Yesterday I had meetings with regional parks, the electoral area committee, the Union of BC Small Water Systems Working Group, and the CREST. So that was my yesterday in Victoria. So the Small Water Systems Working Group, we had a presentation reviewed by Tim Lambert, who is the Executive Director of the Ministry of Health. And he put together a presentation based on what the Small Water Systems has done to date, and he presented it to the medical health officers, was his audience. And it's basically outlining some of the next steps on the microsystems, which are developing health promotion concept and continuous improvement, and no operating permits, various governance models, financial best management practices, and technical best management practices. This will probably be put on our website so people can have access to this information. But he did outline as well the governance model for the Ministry of Health does the basic principles that you operate under, and the health regions are responsible for the enforcement. So in our case, that's the Vancouver Island Health Authority. The Vancouver Island Health Authority focuses on E. coli, but in their responsibility, if there's other issues that they feel might affect health, such as turbidity issues that are health-related, they can take action in that case as well. So the at the UBCM conference to be held in September, our working group are going to be outlining various activities, doing a report on what we've done to date, taking the next steps. Right now it's been focused on surface water, it'll be extended to groundwater, where we're going and next steps. And they also established a subdivision or a sub-group, working group, that will be looking at subdivision activity. And I mentioned at that session that we would want to engage the trust staff and the trustees in letting everybody know what's happening with that, because we are somewhat unique in that regard. And it will basically looking at establishing some water standards for various subdivisions, and obviously we'd want some input on that. The last item I have is we had our annual general meeting of the CREST, which is the Capital Region Emergency Services Telecommunications Board meeting yesterday. Many people in Salt Spring probably don't even know what that is, but it was the 10th anniversary of CREST turns 10. I've left a couple of these brochures at the front here. I'm just going to tell you a bit for those that may not know what CREST is. Providing various radio services for 40 police, fire, ambulance, and other public safety agencies sharing the CREST system, and it allows them to communicate with each other. There's more than 2,400 radios in use from Salt Spring Island to Jordan River. The CREST system averages 8 million calls annually. Of those calls, 99.5% have immediate system access. And for the others, there's an average of 1.1 second delay. Salt Spring is part of the shareholder group. It is a corporation, and I represent Salt Spring Island on that corporation. And last year, to improve service on Salt Spring, there was a new receiver site put on the north end of the island. So for those that are interested, Safety Never Sleeps, there's a couple of brochures in the front that outlines what CREST is all about. But it's one of the many things I'm finding out that many people on the island don't know what kind of involvement the CRD does have. So if you're interested in safety and radio systems, there's a couple of brochures out front. So thank you very much for the opportunity.
Thank you. The regional director never sleeps. Either.
No.
Well, really appreciate the linkages between our respective areas of authority that you're able to knit together, and really want to commend the local trustees for all that cooperation. It really helps a lot.
That's great. Yeah.
We're moving now into the, or any the trustees have any questions of the director? Yes. I'll just recommend anybody in the town hall wants to ask any questions of clarification, I'll trust that you're available for them.
Depends on how hard the question is.
Okay. We next welcome our delegate who's registered in advance, Dr. Varzaliotis. I'll just talk about guidelines for both the delegations and the town hall. And can you move the microphone? Thank you. So we're going to have the same guidelines as usual. We've got three rules of order. Please ask people to speak one at a time through the chair. Giving each speaker your full attention. So side conversations really are distracting, and just welcome you to go out into the sun if you want to talk with your neighbor. Secondly, please address your comments to issues and not personalities. If you make personal comments, I will ask you to stop. And then finally, please not to do anything that would inhibit anybody from expressing an alternate view to yours. Clapping and booing really does have an effect. So if you agree with the person, please just get up and say so. Can I have everybody's cooperation in upholding those guidelines? Thank you. The final one, this is not popular, but while we are videotaping the meeting to enable the public to view what happens at the meetings, we also have a responsibility not to distribute any defamatory material. So if you do make comments that defame a third party, somehow it's okay for you to do that about the trustees, although that does bump into the personal attacks rule, which I also will try to enforce. But it really is important if you do make derogatory comments about a third party who's not here to speak to themselves, then we won't post them on the internet and distribute them. We won't include them in our minutes. So just please ask people to edit themselves. And with that, we welcome Dr. Barzaliotis. We have 5 minutes set aside for your presentation to the Trust Committee. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Madam Chair. I have reasons to believe that pretty soon we are going to have a new website. Mm-hmm. And I want to make two or three points about it. I have made them several times, but I think a reminder might be worthwhile. Your 5 minutes perhaps should be a little bit more flexible to accommodate the type of presentation somebody has to do, because ideas do not fall under the principle on size fits them all. With that said, and the need to give more time will diminish if we have the ideas bank, because people would write the things, so they supplement what they say with a written document, and a document that will stay there in front of the people for a long time. It is a need to expand the local trust committee, which is a parliament, to include more than two or three persons, to include the public. The public has a lot to contribute. There are lots of people out there with lots of ideas who wait an opportunity to come and present those ideas. And I suggest that the local trust committee does the best to harvest them. Harvest those ideas instead of alienating people who want to present them by the method of waste basketing. Things happen if they're kept in focus. They have to be kept in focus. And the idea bank will keep those things in focus. So that would be an extension to what you were saying this morning. I lost it. I won't say. Anyway, certain things were covered this morning. It took so long to come to the point that the ditches would be excluded from the RAR. It needed not be. If you had the support, if the issue was exposed to the public and you had the support of the public to go to the government and say, do what they did, exclude the ditch, this would have happened easier, quicker, and so forth. Because if you go there and say, look, all the people want the ditches out. Do not apply to salt spray. Ditches are man-made. Take them out. They did on their own. But it took so long to do that. It is so long since we are talking about videotaping and recording with even with audio. It should not take that long. If the thing was up there all the time, trustee Groves, who would not have to scratch his head and says, oh, what else we have to attend? What pending subjects are about before us? We have not followed up on the issue of reposting what was censored from the February 23 meeting. We have not followed up on the fact that there was not truth to the claim that it was legal advice and so forth. So those things would be up there all the time. So, and then they will be acted upon. It is a need to expand the three-member parliament, into a larger parliament. Add a little bit direct democracy to representative democracy. That's what amounts to, with a better interface. And nothing is better than the recording and the ideas bank. Inexpensive, ready, available 24/7 for everybody to do it. And as I said earlier to somebody, once somebody has to write something, he has to think about it. And he would not write something just because on the spur of the moment. It would happen, but it would not happen often. So you will get good ideas and would help you to govern us, if I may so. I do not know if it's any question that I, for me, I will answer any question on any subject that I have brought up now or before or at any time.
Trustee Grove,
do you have
a question?
Yes, yeah, I mean, I like your ideas bank, as you know, because we've talked about it. Would you consider it something akin to a blog? So people would write in with their ideas, and then there may be some kind of a conversation. Is a blog the way of defining it?
If I had my way, the way I think of it, I would have it that the other person can put their ideas on in writing. It may amount to a blog at the end. But it would not be just concentrated there, because you want the people to think and add to it. And it's better if they just put their own entry. They can put their thing on the ideas bank, and it would be there. And they would say, Tom Barzilotis presented, said that we should have videotaping. Peter Gross says that we should have audio recording only for this and this and these reasons. So it's all before the people.
But anybody could basically write it.
That's right. That's right.
So there would then be a debate. Probably.
That's right. Well, if it's, I don't know about the format, about whether it should be one after the other in a thread. But as long as people who have different point of view are having equal opportunity to come and present their ideas and put them on the ideas market, on the public, before the public eye. That is the important thing, and that they are kept there. And if they're classified, let's say, a riparian area, and then you will have all the ideas that people have down there before your eyes with the abstracted form. And that is the main thing that people should put an abstract, provide an abstract, 30-word abstract, to what it is about, what they bring about. And then those abstracts would be classified and put there. And anybody will go and see what Tom Barzilotti said, and if he wants, he will click into it and get the whole document. That's the idea. So with those small abstracts, everybody will know whether they are interested or they have something to contribute, or they do not. And the people who have something to say about the RAP will go and say it. They will have the opportunity anytime from their own home. They will think down, sit down, think, and write it. I think it's productive. I think it's essential, especially on issues of local government, due to the fact that the 10,000 population local government cannot have a parliament of 20 or 30 people so as to have a wider perspective of what's happening in society. Mm-hmm. Look at the Ganges, I call it eyesore, next to the gazebo. I brought the thing 2 years ago. before trust. And of course, we will do some. That was very well received and one of the rare opportunities that I had to discuss it. And I discussed it. It's dead. Nothing has happened. It's dangerous and it's an eyesore. Why should we wait until somebody sues the community because they would break their legs or a kid might be crushed by a rock? I was there the other day and said, a rock there that could very easily kill somebody, like the fellow who was, where was in Montreal, that the bricks fell on his head while he was walking the street. It's a nice show to start with. There's no reason for it to be like that. It should be added. But if it was kept in front of the public eye, perhaps something would have been done. And that's the idea of the ideas bank.
As you know, I'm putting in touch with the people in Victoria who are working on our website, so hopefully this is something we'll be able to achieve. I don't know.
It is easy. The chair said that we will have it.
Good. Thank you. We're at 10 minutes now. So
well,
I'm
thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your presentation. You've participated really constructively in your website consultation, and I know that's been appreciated by the staff that are doing it, but we haven't had very much of a political link to that. So I'll look to the trustees if there's anything that you'd like to advance in this area. Maybe when we talk about the work program might be the right place to do that. But if there's anything you'd like to carry forward of Dr. Varsalios' ideas, we'll look to direction from
thank
you.
Thank you for flexibility. It reminds me of the CBC manual, which says we have to be flexible, lest we become rigid.
I think our meetings are flexible. We are trying. Thanks very much for your presentation. If we can move now into the town hall section, let's get a show of hands of people that would like to address the trust committee. Just four hands. And if you are the representative of an applicant, you have time saved for you within the development application. So ideally, we'll hear first from people that do have input on decisions we're going to make today. That is the medical clinic rezoning and the subdivision water covenants. But again, the representatives for those applications, they can talk once we get to their point on the agenda. Anybody have submissions on either of the development applications we're looking at today? No, then we'll just go to anything that is local trust committee business, and let's start on this side of the room. Thank you.
My name is Ron Hawkins, and I'm here to speak about the subject of legalized suites. Most of my comments will pertain to water. And as a preface to my comments, I'd just like to respond to a couple of the announcements that your reports alluded to. Wayne, in his comment that the VHA can, I think, quote, take action on other issues like water health, for example, turbidity, if they feel it's necessary. That's very hopeful. I would hope that included in that, they might begin to look at toxins and algae and nutrient loading as such an issue, not currently recognized as anything relevant to water in VHA's mandate. George, your comment about the formation of the working group on salt spring water delivery is also very promising. These four bodies that are proposed to come together and address this very pressing concern is really constructive. VHA and CRD, largely being off-island expertise and very useful expertise, and Islands Trust and the Salt Spring Water District being on-island expertise, I would say that there is other community expertise in the community outside those bodies on which I'm sure you will welcome and rely on information. As you well know, Salt Spring Water Council has functioned for many years, and it is quite a repository of expertise. And I'll speak to some of that now. Incidentally, I am not an expert. I don't believe there is such a thing. I have some questions. I have some knowledge, and I'm here to learn and help you. This information stands to be scrutinized. So I'll read. Dear trustees, I wrote to you earlier on this subject as it relates to drinking watersheds, subject of legalized suites, following our additional comments for your consideration. One, water supply. Where will the water for legalized suites come from? This begs the question of what are the limits of supply? The North Salt Spring Waterworks District limits of licensed supply for Mary Lake are between lake elevation 40.0 and 40.7 meters, i.e. 0.7 of a meter or 28 inches of surface water. That's the licensed supply limit. This equals approximately 10 million gallons per inch or 280 million gallons. Of this, now bear in mind that 280 million gallons goes up and down as per precipitation and extraction, but you operate only in that limit. Of this 140 million, of this 280, 140 million gallons is typically lost to evaporation, 60 million to stream flow under federal fisheries law, which leaves 80 million in the above scenario for the waterworks. I believe current Mary Lake consumption is more than this, but winter flow surplus can be discounted. In the summer of 2009, Mary Lake declined to 40.09 meters from 40.7, leaving approximately 35 million gallons of supply before fall precipitation. 35 million gallons, I'm guessing, is 2 to 3 weeks supply in peak dry season. This is a narrow buffer against unforeseeable dry years. Maxwell Lake supply in a 1 in 10 dry year is about 85 million gallons, or in a 1 in 50 dry year, 56 million gallons. What used to be a 1 in 50 drought may become more like a 1 in 25 year drought if you think that climate is warming. In 1987, a dry year, Maxwell dropped to within 1 foot of the water intake. Current climate understanding, while still evolving, is that very recent summers are slightly drier than previous. This is from CRD Water Services, May 2012. Maxwell demand is currently 71 million gallons. And again, to put that in context, a 1 in 10 dry year limit is 85 million. In addition, Salt Spring Water District, or Salt Spring, has several hundred outstanding legal obligations to supply future customers, noticeably in Channel Bridge. Moreover, they hold the view their fundamental mandate is to serve the public need with respect to water, be they within the district, dry groundwater consumers outside the district, or future expansion of the district. They do not address limits of supply or the implications of these options. Water conservation is a hopeful yet unknown source of supply, which will require regulation to enforce after willing compliance is tapped. Costs must rise as consumption declines to meet the cost of badly deferred infrastructure replacement and population growth. The message, pay more for less. It's not palatable, to say the least, and it's unavoidable. rainwater catchment is promising, initially costly, but efficient in the long term. Desalination, another individual opt-out choice, is costly, particularly with respect to energy input. Groundwater, the source of 45% of our water, is unknown and uncertain potential. It's definitely a do-it-yourself risk scenario, wherein fallback on the responsibility or the ability of the water district supply cannot be assumed. As has been debated at great length by Water Council, of which North Salt Spring Water Works District is a part, the version of interbasin drainages, example Cushion Lake to North Salt Spring system, or additional damming, excessive drawdown of Mary Lake or Maxwell to increase storage, all these would result in serious problems of nutrient loading, water quality, human health risk, ecological destruction, recreational enjoyment, private property intrusion, and unknown financial expense. Water Council did not support Bob Watson, the North Salt Spring trustee on Water Council's, did not support his what-if scenario reports of 209 and 210. Very constructive, helpful thinking, but in the end, they didn't favor these scenarios, as mentioned, which, because they did not address the specifics of those of these concerns above. Conclusion, additional supply from the surface water lakes is tenuous. Future development permits issued by Islands Trust requires much tighter supply demand accountability to expedite responsible land use planning. When asked by the Trust if there is water to service a particular development, North Salt Spring Water Works' response tends to be, I believe, yes, without any accounting of supply-demand limits and a running balance. I say where? How much? How have current and future contingencies been accounted? Let this be public information. Please understand, and the Salt Spring Water Works District is doing the best job it can. They're my friends, and I appreciate their work very much. However, I don't agree with or understand their thinking or assumptions at times, or lapse of same. They seem to have the attitude there's lots of water. I'd like to know where it is. These concerns are too serious not to be publicly understood. For this reason, I am copying North Salt Spring Water Works District with this correspondence and would appreciate a copy of their response. So that sums up my concerns with respect to water and legal and suite.
I think we're going to move to another speaker, and if we've got time at the end, then we'll...
Thank you very much.
It's
for
really
the opportunity.
Helpful, and I hope that if we don't have time, that you'll be able to submit your stuff in writing and we can give it...
Yes, I believe that has been done.
Yeah, great. No, thank I you. Really appreciate the work and the numbers, and we did look at some of that this morning as well. It's helpful to the work we're doing now. Let's go next.
The question has come up, does the North Salt Spring Water Works District have enough water to serve secondary streets and cottages in their service area? To answer that question, this letter was written by Mike Larmore, who is a former manager of the North Salt Spring Water District and a former Islands trustee, and he asked me to read the letter for him since he could not be here today. It's just one page. All freshwater supplies within British Columbia are owned by the provincial crown. Surface water is allocated under license for various uses under provisions of the Water Act, but there are no guarantees as to the quantity or quality being available at all times. Groundwater is currently not subject to licensing. The basis for water planning by the Ministry of Environment on Salt Spring Island
has been the Salt Spring Island Water Allocation Plan, which was developed with the intent of protecting fisheries values and sharing water supplies in the community. In my view, that is Michael's view, water demand within the North Salt Spring Waterworks District is approaching feasible limits. Both St. Mary Lake and Maxwell Lake have been dammed to provide more storage. The weir, that is a dam, at St. Mary Lake retards the natural flushing rate of the lake, in turn contributing to the proliferation of cyanobacterial blooms, which may be toxic in drinking water at times. Cyanobacteria, such as the dominant species in St. Mary Lake currently called Aphanus zamenon, constitute a serious threat to drinking water sources and recreational use of the lake. Dr. Rick Nordine thinks the problem could get worse. Are we wise to become even more dependent on St. Mary Lake, as the North Salt Spring Waterworks would suggest as a long-term priority in their report to the annual general meeting? North Salt Spring Waterworks District license on St. Mary Lake specifies a minimum lake elevation of 40.0 meters GSC. In the summer of 2009, the lake declined from 40.7 meters to 40.09 meters, which would suggest there is little or no spare capacity left in that lake. To increase storage will impact on private property and further impact water quality in the lake, as well as cost a lot of money. At Maxwell Lake, to obtain more storage capacity, a dam has been built, land has been cleared on a 30-foot wide strip all around the perimeter of the lake, a house was relocated, and new driveway built, all in one pristine lake on this island. With the resultant higher water demand brought about by this increased supply, the lake will experience greater fluctuations, which will impact on the littoral zone. I think that's the riparian zone around the lake. The estimated capacity of the lake in a 1 in 10 dry years is about 85 million gallons per year. The current demand is about 71 million gallons per year. In addition to meeting the current demands, which may fluctuate from year to year, depending on water conditions and the economy, the district has considerable additional commitments to provide water that must be met, including the remainder of Channel Ridge, empty lots within the district, as well as responding to effects of climate change. Therefore, I would conclude there is little or no spare capacity within the North Salt Spring Waterworks District without incurring high costs to district ratepayers and the environment. Mike Larmore. And I think he already submitted this to you.
Thank you. On our morning agenda. Thanks very much for reading it. Appreciate getting the former trustees' advice very much. There are other hands for the town hall. Go ahead, in the front row.
There's a couple things I want to talk about. One was basically to do with rainwater catchment, and because I've did quite a bit of research, just because it always seems to come up that this is our answer on Salt Spring. And from what I've learned and from talking to various people, is that number one thing with rainwater catchment is we allow people to go build in areas that we currently can't build in. So we end up, in Salt Spring in particular, our first recharge area is our highest points of the island. So we go up there and we destroy the Gary Oak ecosystem and the arbutus and all these other trees that are getting more on the danger list. And so the other concern is that have with the rainwater catchment is that when the people who, we've always talked about the island, we don't want it to become a place for, it's headed more and more over the years for a place for the rich and famous because of everything keeps rising in property values and taxes and everything else. But when you get people that come here and they have the money, they can basically store as much water as they want. And because we have no groundwater legislation in British Columbia, they basically can hold that water back in the winter. And the poor people in the summer, if you build like 20,000 gallon tanks or whatever, then don't get recharged to the groundwater lower down below, right? So the other big thing is on Salt Spring, because we use a lot of wood-burning stoves, the particulate matter, if you look into the research, is quite a concern when you have rainwater catchment. And the other thing that was pointed out to me by one of the labs was that actually they had rainwater catchment area because cyanobacteria algal blooms, the algae spores can travel through the air. And they actually had one where this rainwater catchment system actually had high levels of toxins, because what was happening is the tanks were overflowing and the people didn't like the erosion it was causing, which was really good that they got rid of that. But they put fine gravel there, and because they had the cyanobacteria bloom in the tank, the toxins were present. And when they hit the actual rock, they broke open the cells, and they actually were running into somebody's well on a neighboring property. This is from a well-known source in one of the labs. I agree with rainwater catchment, but I find that we keep using that as an example. Okay, we have all this 1 meter of water, but 1 meter of water we get is, unfortunately, most of what we get in the winter. From all the work we did on the Cushion Management Plan, and if you go back to all the work that was done by Water Survey of Canada, when they seemed to be really concerned in the 70s, when the Island Trust was first formed because of all the development starting and everything else, they looked at all the flow rates in the creeks and the lakes and the levels, and they had all these different gauges, which they don't even maintain or look after anymore. In fact, we asked them to try to move one, and they said, basically, if you want to pay all the money for the surveyors and everything else and have it moved, it's in our management plan. We asked to have it moved to a different location because it's currently not even monitored. It's very difficult to get to on Cushion. But what I was going to say there is they seem to be really concerned about it. They did all these studies and the phytoplanktons and all these zooplanktons and all this other stuff. And since then, because of lack of staff and resources and time, they basically made it clear that the stewardship groups, and this is why I started working on Cushion, because at that time Peter Law was the one who basically encouraged me to get a stewardship group going because there was none going on the Gulf Islands. And they were starting on the Vancouver Island, and they were also had active ones going because of all the problems they had in the Okanagan. But what I look at is we've got management plans that we've worked on, and we've worked 4 years on the Cushion one, and we had so many people like Dr. John Sprague, Dr. Carol Kelly, who was with the Freshwater Institute in Manitoba. I haven't talked to her lately, so I'm not sure if she's still there working in that department. And we had all these other people that this is a field of expertise. So we came up with all these recommendations, how to try to protect the water, but we don't want to see this document just being a fancy document, because that's what they're having trouble in Vancouver Island even. These documents look like a real nice piece of work. They sit on a shelf and nothing happens. We see the water quality, unfortunately, on St. Mary's Lake when you drive by. It's just disaster. I mean, it's an absolute disgrace that we've let this water get to that point. And the concern I have with all this is that we made all these things. We put the different departments that we thought that we were willing to work with and try to help. And this is not my field of expertise. This is the first thing I will say. Because I've learned all this from basically all the people that I've worked with for the last 20 years on this. And I just fail to understand why we keep putting our water at risk. I know we need affordable housing, but a perfect example is Maxwell Lake last year. They used Maxwell when the toxin levels got really high in St. Mary's. They swung into Maxwell. If you look at the pilot project, we covered the Maxwell area. That's the water that's supplying from Maxwell over on Salt Spring Way and all that area in there. Where do we go if the toxin levels are really high? I realize right now they're adding lots of chlorine and they're destroying the toxin levels. But the thing is, the disinfectant byproducts they're creating, nobody's checking for all these disinfectant byproducts other than trihalomethanes and haloacetones, but there's all kinds of other ones. Deb Epson, Ministry of Environment, did her study, her thesis on this, so she knows all the disinfectant byproducts that are created. Azit Mazumdar over in the UVic lab, all these people, I mean, there's so many people that have worked and tried to help Salt Spring get a handle on their water problems, and yet we sit here and all we say is, read the paper, no problem on St. Mary's. It's as fun as we pour the chlorine to it. What about all those individual water licenses that are a lot of elderly and some young families? Because remember, cyanobacteria toxins really affect the young families the worst, the young kids, because it goes by body weight, right? And we've had Loxley in St. Mary's Lake. If you go back and look at Bob Watson's reports, you will see that we actually got last year to levels higher than you were allowed to swim and use recreationally. And yet nobody reports it to the Drinking Water Protection Officer, Barry Betker, over in Vancouver Island, until I talk to him, He had no idea there was even a bloom going on. So somehow we got to get a method of communication going, because why do we have a drinking water protection officer under the Drinking Water Protection Act, which was formed in 2003, if we aren't going to use those resources? And I know the water districts don't want to, and I know I'm not going to make any friends because I did not remove my name from this. But what I'm saying is we have to somehow get a handle on this water and prevent these toxic algal blooms from occurring. So we need all of your support to make this happen. And that's about all I can say, is that without your support, the volunteers are just batting their heads. We've tried to educate. We've did everything we can. And we're at the point where we just say, we go by St. Mary's Lake and say, what for? Why did we give up all this time to try to protect the water in Salisbury? Thank you.
Thank you very much for your work and for your strong reminder. It's very topical.
And we'll be talking about this this afternoon in our work program. Thanks very much. You would like to talk about something other than your application.
Absolutely.
Good man.
Absolutely.
You have diverse interests.
And I am here. I am not representing absolutely anybody, but I think this is something you guys should dig your teeth into.
Great.
The HST.
Really?
As you know, you may or may not be aware, but anyways, HST came in and there was a $26,000 rebate on new home construction and so on and so forth if you lived in the home. In February, they brought out their new budget and said, it's $42,500 now on recreational properties, which they added, and secondary homes. We're not included in that list, just so you know. I'm mm-hmm. sure we, the CRD,
yeah, we know.
Okay? and as you know, there are many contractors not working on this island, and I'm not here speaking for them on their behalf. It's just me, okay? We have to wait until April, and I know that a lot of these guys are unemployed right now, and they're just sitting there. People are sitting there, well, I'm going to wait until the HST's gone, and then I'll put you under contract. They could get $42,500 back right now. They probably would be putting some of these people to work. And I know Port Renfrew is not included in this. Juan de Fuca, Southern Gulf Islands. I think it's an absolute joke. And I personally, I brought the article out of Times Colonist, but I was on this before. I have actually phoned our MLA, but he's never phoned me back. Probably a good thing, because after I'd be done with them, I'd probably get audited. But I think you guys should sink your teeth into this and write a letter of support to these people, because I know they're aware of it. I brought the article. I just think I think it's almost discriminatory that we're not included in this. That's just my opinion. I brought three, one for each of you. And my thought was, if a letter could go from the CRD, which seems to be on this already, in Port Renfrew, Mr. Hicks, and the trustees, and even, I don't know if trust council would get behind it, but it affects rural areas. And, when the contractors aren't busy, there's awful lot of spin-off economic benefit to all parties on Salt Spring Island, you know. I was in a restaurant the other day, and it was quiet at lunch. And he says, it's none of the contractors aren't busy, so it's slow. So it affects a lot of things. It's just something simple. I just thought that you could, I'll leave it to you. If you don't want to do anything, that's okay. But I just thought it was good.
With the trustees' agreement, can I ask our regional director to add some context here?
Please.
Wayne McIntyre.
Okay.
Back in the spotlight.
Yeah. Thank you, Miles. Just to give you a little background, I know you referred to the letter from Mike Hicks. That was really a collective letter that we reviewed at the Electoral Area Commission, so it was on all of our behalfs. Since then, there's been a communication with the Driftwood through Elizabeth Nolan asking me a bunch of questions. I supplied her with the original letter, the letter back from the ministry, from Kevin Falcon's office, and a response back to that letter. So there's been a lot of action in that regard, and my comment to Elizabeth Nolan was the fact that it's discriminatory. Why restrict the CRD when it has lots of rural areas that affect people and construction and so forth? And Metro Vancouver probably makes a lot more sense, but there's a lot of areas, particularly the electoral areas of the CRD, that are affected significantly. So So that's been done. All that communication's been made. I'd certainly be happy to make copies available to you.
No, that's great.
Yeah, so it's all gone back and forth and gone to the CRD board, so it's a very well publicized and action has been taken.
Perfect. Good.
See how fast local government acts?
Good. Okay. No, that's fantastic.
Yeah, so.
Great. And maybe if the local trustees have a sense that this is something that you'd like to reinforce the CRD's action, then we could talk about it at our next meeting, or we could even look at it, getting it on the council agenda, and the deadline is relatively soon.
Yes. Great.
Thanks very much for your work. It's good you're here. Would you like to add something?
Just the only other, I guess, thing that's the unknown is with the removal of the HST, what's going to happen with these? So we have no idea. So. But I think you've got to get it on the table, and that has been done. So we'll be monitoring it. And so.
Thanks very much for bringing it to our attention. Very good. Any other town hall speakers who haven't had a chance to talk already? We've pretty much sped through our time. Would the trustees like to hear from Mr. Hawkins a second time, or do you want to move into the application phase? We do have a number of people that are waiting here.
If there were other points apart from the water issue, which I think we're cognizant of and we understand, but if you had points additional to that and other topics, then I'd be interested to hear what they are.
Just 30 seconds, very little.
Let's hear from you briefly and then we'll move on.
Sure.
Thank you.
I didn't bring copies because Justine said that she would make those available. So just to conclude my remarks, the other aspect on legalized suites is what I would term legal. Should people who illegally occupy or rent out property be entitled to comment on the legality of such a question?
Actually, Mr. Hawkins, with respect, I think this is maybe the final part of your letter, which we did add to our agenda this morning.
That's the part. I didn't read that. If you're inviting me to, that's what I'm doing. But
I think actually just for the sake of time, because we did take your letter as late correspondence, it's on the public agenda, and so if members of the public want to see it, it'll be on our website quite soon under the late package. And thank you again very much for writing it down. It means we were able to draw on it this morning. Thanks again for your patience there and to the other members of the public who are waiting. I'm going to ask us to move into section 12, which is the applications and permits section. Thanks very much for joining us. Or do you want to? Are people intending to leave? Or when we move into that? No, you're all there. So I don't think I will do a break. I think we'll just move us right into the application. Okay, we are going to do a break. 5 minutes to leave if you're going to leave, and then we'll come back to work in section 12.